Renaissance man. He doesn't need that much of an introduction. Please welcome the great William Shatner. What did you say? You could possibly have interfered with that money and get a laugh. So hold on. This is not a conversation. So I said to the, he's got my credit card. And then he looks at me. And he looks back at the credit card. Then he looks at me, and he says, is that you? And I go, And he says, oh, my God, how time flies. He said, I thought you were taller. I said, I am. My knees are buckling. How are you?
Fine.
Nice,
fine.
To see you.
Nice to see you.
I want to put, please, yes, absolutely. This film in its context, historical context. So, I don't know what year, in the 70s, or that the Star Wars comes out. Star Wars comes out. And there must have been, can you imagine the meeting at Paramount Studios? Guys are all sitting out there, they got the Star Wars. What have we got? They got Star Wars. And some guy says, remember that series way back? It was on for 3 years and nobody kind of liked it. We got that. So they said, well, let's make a movie of that. And then we'll get all the box office that Star Wars has. So they write a movie called, they call it Star Trek the Movie. And we're going to get a big director, get Robert Wise.
Really good director.
An A-list director, Robert Wise. He'd just come off of West Side Story. He was Orson Welles' editor.
On Citizen Kane.
On Citizen Kane.
Wow.
I mean, this was a great... And the story is, he didn't want to do it. I don't know. What is this Star Trek thing? And his wife says, Bobby, are you crazy? You got to do this. And Bobby says, okay, I'm going to do it. So he does it. And there were all kinds of production problems, if I remember correctly, and it went very slowly. And Doug Trumbull, who was the special effects guy, computer graphics hadn't made it quite then, not like today. I mean, there was a struggle of how do you do it, where do you go, and algorithms, you know about algorithms.
Oh, sure, yeah. Sure.
And so, Doug Trumbull had, trouble, okay? And literally, the film arrived in Washington, D.C. the evening that it was going to be put on at a theater in Washington to the president and everything like that. That's how it debuted. And Robert Wise, the great editor, hadn't had a chance to edit the special effects, which went on quite a long time. And so the movie wasn't at its best. It was good enough. It didn't do so well. Ultimately, it did fine, but it didn't do so well. So the people at Paramount said, "You see, I told you we shouldn't have done it. We're not going to do it anymore." And the head of Paramount Studios, what was his name? He goes home and he says, "Well, that's it." And his wife says, "Are you crazy? You got to do it again. That wasn't a Star Trek movie. That was a..." And he says, "Okay, we'll do another one. We'll do it more cheaply." So the Me Too movement back then began Star Trek II. So we made it, the television arm made that movie for one quarter of the cost that the other movie had cost, and that began the cycle all over again. That's all I've got to say.
I hope that's not the case. Please have a seat, Bill. Here's the thing.
What's the thing?
Here's the thing, Bill. The first Star Trek movie...
Gee, you can cross your legs like that. I can't.
Sorry, Bill. I'm not manspreading, though, my friends.
That's so hip replacement.
This first movie, I don't even remember the first movie, but the second one was boffo. It was, you guys just watched it. It's a wonderful film. Why do you think the audience is caught on with this film where they didn't?
Well, I think this movie reflects the way the series at its best went. The series at its best was filled with ideas, really great writers. I had had an interest in science fiction prior to the series. I had read all those guys' names, Theodore Sturgeon and Asimov and all those guys.
They
loved Star Trek, and they came to write, and they wrote stories that our television writers then made into television scripts. Quite a different form to writing a novel and writing a television script. So they would have the ideas, and then our writers would take credit for the idea. write it and say, "Oh, see this wonderful science fiction idea I have had," whereas it was one of the great writers who didn't care, because the ideas are a dime a dozen, it's how you execute them. So I met many of the people that I had read years before. And science fiction is a extraordinary literary device. It projects the future. Nobody knows the future. We don't know what's going to happen when I come down the stage. I may step off the stage and fall and faint and land in your arms and die in your arms. And we don't know what the future is. So everybody's opinion is the equal of everybody else's. Whatever you think is going to be in the future is going to be. That's what's going to be, unless it's not going to be.
That's very profound.
Yeah.
Buddhist, really. We'll get to that.
Buddhist in its concept.
Yes. Ricardo Montalban. You knew him.
Ricardo Montalban.
You knew him years before this movie. He was on the original series. He was on the original.
It's mystical. It is the stuff of mysticism. Years and years ago, I was born in Montreal, and I have to get that guy up here and ask, why did he go, "Whoa, whoa, 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 whoa"? What does that sound mean? And why did you do it to Montreal? It's so idiotic. It's the altitude.
Well, it's what's legal at this altitude.
It's what's legal.
Yes, sir.
Oh, that's true. Where can you be illegal here? Well, you're suggesting what he's done is illegal.
No, I'm suggesting that he is high on marijuana. Because it's legal here.
You see how wars begin? I knew exactly what you meant, and I said, where can you get where can you be illegal here? And you had no idea what I was talking about.
I did not.
How can Kim Il-sung talk to Trump and have an understanding when you and I don't care anymore?
I think you can start here, Bill.
Okay, I can start here. So where was I? Montreal.
Montreal.
So I'm in Montreal, I'm in my teens, and I go down to New York, and I see a musical, and I learned later, much later, I think it was called Jamaica, and there was this young actor, dancer, that I thought, wow, that guy is really good, handsome, and a great dancer. Then I come to Hollywood, and I see him in films, in Latin Lover, his name is Ricardo Montalban. And then I do a series, the Star Trek, and he comes on, and he's Ricardo Montalban. but I mean, he was like, he was regal, he was majestic, he was he came from Mexico, so the Mexican people worshipped him because he had made it in Hollywood in English. He also spoke Spanish. He was a Spanish star. Became an English. He had done something so few people had done. So they began to, you know, Ricardo Montalban. And I became part of that worshiping group because he was so good. And he was so wonderful in the series. Then, and by that time he's walking with a limp. And he said, well, I fell off a horse. So then I see him later, and instead of a cane, he's got a walker. Then he's and finally he's in a wheelchair. This beautiful, athletic man is in a wheelchair. The spirit of Ricardo Montalban is still there, but it's in a wheelchair. And I loved him. When we finished the film, I used to go to his house. We'd have talks, and he died. He died, not paraplegic, but he was really crippled up, except for his upper body. He had these magnificent pecs. And I told him again and again how I envied his pecs. Ricardo, give me a pec. He was a wonderful guy. I love him.
This is interesting, though. We just watched the movie. You don't actually appear in the same scene with Ricardo Montalban.
That's true.
In the movie, he's on the screen.
Yes.
Why didn't the two of you share a scene together?
Why? You ask why? Why are we a mile high in the air? We don't know. We just are. That's the way the screenplay was written. I mean, I couldn't go visit him.
It seems like
he's on the island and I'm on the ship. And I scream at him, Ricardo. He doesn't hear me. Ricardo! Oh, his name is Tom.
So iconic. Thank you, guys.
Iconic.
Wow.
Really, that was good. That was worth the evening. We can all go home.
I also read, straighten me out on this, that when the...
How do you wish me to straighten you out?
Well,
them's funny ones.
We'll find out. I also read that Leonard Nimoy, when the fans of the show found out that he was going to die in the movie when it was in production, they were so upset that he actually received death threats. That's insane. Did you ever hear that?
Yeah. Because he wanted to get out of the show, he was going to die, the character was going to die, and they were going to kill him. I mean, they could have filmed it, you know. Some irate fan kills Leonard Nimoy, and we film it as the death of Spock. Nobody saw that one.
It's a box office.
That would have been good. He wouldn't have been able to write his book, I Am Not Spock. He could have written the book, I Die, the Spock. We joke. They told me, Leonard and he was my brother. He was the brother I never had. We had so much in common. Backgrounds, careers, family, every possible category you could mention, we had such similarity. So we were great buddies. And you know, most casts that I've ever heard of, certainly everyone I've been in, but the people I've talked to, they might have a long run in a play. I did 2 years on Broadway in one play, a year in another play. So in that length of time you're on stage, you've got to, whether it's there's a camera there or whether there's an audience looking at you, you've got to be with that. You've got to be present, and you've got to be there. And I'm depending on you to know your words and not be slightly addled by illegal substances. and I'm depending on you, like it's like war. I'm depending on you, my buddy, to be there for that evening or that day. And so we often term it in that way, actors. We term it like going to war, and we're buddies in a foxhole together. And that's when Leonard and the rest of many of the members, not all, were foxhole buddies in that. And then when the show is over, play is done, the series is canceled, the movie's done, you go your way and you think, hey, my buddy, you're my buddy in the foxhole, I'll call you tomorrow. Ooh, I can't call you tomorrow because I got an appointment, but I'll call you the day. No, I can't call you the day after. And it just goes. And James Spader, I spent 5 years with on the... My dear friend, I haven't seen him since the show was canceled. I've talked to him two, three times. I love you, I'll see you. Yeah. He's busy, I'm busy. We just have... Is that the same guy with the boot?
My stereophonic ears tell me otherwise. It was somewhere back there.
Okay. The stereophonic hearing?
Yes.
You still got stereophonic hearing?
Yeah, I
do. I need a bell. So, casts disappear. But in this case, with Leonard, because we appeared in Comic-Cons and talks and interviews and movies, and we were thrust into each other's presence so much, the at war feeling began to dissipate, and we became social friends and our wives and the children and all that kind of thing. So it was deeper than that. I had the best time. He was my dearest friend.
That's nice.
I wrote a book called Leonard.
And you have another book coming out this fall, by the way.
This fall, the book is called Live Long and ... Live Long and you figure it out.
I have one last question about Khan. We have a lot more to talk about. We have some questions from the audience, too. You were about 50 when this film went into production.
I was?
You were.
Jeez, that's old.
Well, it's about where I am right now.
Get out of years.
Did you have any reservations about playing Captain Kirk at the age of 50?
No, I made reservations at a hotel because of the... I left my reservations at home. I was getting well paid. Why would I have to work? No, you know, I worked out hard and I was okay. And dimly in my mind, and it came to pass, and I begat. It's biblical in meaning. It came to pass that the aging of the Kirk was dramatized. So the glasses step slower, don't hit me, you know, that kind of thing. Don't hit me, you'll knock my teeth out, don't do that.
Would you like to answer a question? We have several questions from people here in the audience written tonight.
That's why I'm here.
Oh! Jim from Longmont wants to know, this is by the way, Jim from Longmont, this is a perfect example of the intellect you're going to receive in this city that you're not going to receive elsewhere. How do you tell the sex of a tribble?
How do you tell them? I've been at this a long time. Right? I've heard every question there is to ask, right? I have never heard that question. Never. And I never want to hear it again.
Tiffany has a question, Bill. This is a little more heady.
Heady?
Heady.
Heavy?
Heady and heavy. How would things have been different if the crew of the Enterprise had today's social media, and what would Kirk's Twitter handle be?
Well, I hate questions. Well, you know, you're expecting me to come up with something terrific, right? I can't think of a thing. You know what my handle would be? Kobayashi Maru. That's for the Cub Descendi. That means people who know, okay? Yeah, it's pretty good.
The next few minutes of this interview are, I have to say, are for me, because this is the first time I've had an opportunity to sit down with you. Leonard Nimoy made some good records. Yours were better. Here's an album.
This year, like to hear that. This year, just rolled over twice.
1968. So this is the 50th anniversary of a soft psychedelic masterpiece called The Transformed Man. Do you know this album? Now see, in the 80s, Rhino Records took a couple of cuts on a copy of a cover of Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds and Mr. Tambourine Man, which, you know, Mr. Tambourine, you're great on that. But when you hear those cuts, you hear them out of context into what you and your friends were trying to do with this magnificent album. Comments.
Well, thank you for that.
You're welcome.
You know, that, I tell you, the meaning behind that is manyfold. Manyfold, which involves benfolds.
Okay. Oh, God.
And it does. I really appreciate you saying that. Because I was a young actor involved in Star Trek, and this big record company says to me, would you like to make an album? And I said, wow. Make an album, yeah. And I have a concept. And they said, what's the concept? I said, I'll take great poetry, great literature, classical literature, which I acted in Shakespeare in Canada. I was a classical actor, okay. So I was versed in the classics. I had a feeling for poetry, and I thought, I'll do some of the great classics. And then segue into a song that either has the same philosophy or contrast philosophy of the literature of the time, which was lyrics in a song. So I would choose a piece of poetry, a piece of literature, to be or not to be. To be or not to be, that is the question. The question is to die or not to die. That's the question Hamlet poses. With music written underneath, segues into a song called It was a Very Good Life. It was a
Very Good Year.
A Very Good Year. In which the guy is an older guy celebrating it was a very good year. The year when I was 21, the year when I and I acted the song of 20, and I had Hamlet saying, I don't want to live, and this guy saying, what a wonderful life is. Wow. Cyrano de Bergerac. I may climb to no great heights, but I will climb alone. Segues into a drug song. Mr. Tambourine Man is a drug song. He needs help. He can't climb alone. So I have Cyrano de Bergerac. Oh God, Mr. Tambourine Man, who's a drug dealer, Mr. Tambourine Man. So now I'm going to do publicity for
the Transformers.
I'm on the Johnny Carson show. Johnny Carson, millions. I was eight. Johnny Carson had me on the show, and I was going to do a number. I was going to do a cut. I was going to do Cyrano de Bergerac and Mr. Tambourine Man. So I do it in rehearsal, and the producer comes up to me and says, that's 6 minutes long. You've only got 3 minutes. What do you want to do, the poetry or the song? Jeez, I don't know. I'll do the song. So now, he stands, and yes, but I'll sit immediately. I'm doing Mr. Tambourine Man on the Tonight Show. Mr. Tambourine. And I look over and I see Johnny Carson going, what the fuck? That's what the audience did, and that's what I did. And so it was years later that Ben Folds sees my record in a garage sale.
It's a masterpiece, and it's
in a garage sale, man. It's like the Mona Lisa in the trunk of a car.
That's how I feel about it.
Yes, it takes two of us.
So Ben Folds.
Then Ben Folds, this great musician, and I get together, and we make an album called Has Been, which has been long. And by the way, all that leads to more albums, and then this year, you're gonna die. You're gonna die, everybody. Two albums. A country music album.
Oh God.
Super. The group Alabama, Jeff Cook, doing with Jeff Cook, and other great musicians, and a Christmas album. You may laugh, because it's called Shatner Claus. So the country music album comes out in about 2 months, October, for the Christmas album, and the book is somewhere in between.
How does this guy do this? You're what, 74? I don't know how old you are. 64?
You know, it was an evil lie that I was 50 when I did that. I'm 50 now.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for indulging me in regards to the music, because I'm really a big fan. This amazing career that you have. I do want to ask you a question or two, though. Someone wants to know, who was your favorite co-star in the Star Trek series?
Who? No. I wrote a book, as I said, about Leonard, who obviously was my dear friend. But, you know, Forrest Kelly. Forrest Kelly was a wonderful Southern gentleman. I got it.
Great.
I'm standing once again. Oh, I hope you don't mind. So, I used to be a bow hunter. You'll forgive me because I don't hunt anymore. I don't believe in killing anything anymore. But, yeah. There's somebody over there who believes in killing jokes, but. But what it taught me, Bob, you gotta stalk the game. You gotta be really careful about the game. Slowly approach it and know where the game may be over. Okay? You gotta be really careful. You gotta observe when you're a bow hunter. Because you got hit within 30, 40 yards at most. 20. Be good. So I observe people. In the middle of the night when you're shooting film, like the middle of the night any time when you're talking, you reveal things that you wouldn't reveal ordinarily in the daylight hours. It's the middle of the night, sounds are muted, your mind is elsewhere. And DeForest Kelly revealed to me one night when we were shooting, I'm afraid that I'm forgetting my memory. It's fatigue. It's not everybody goes, you'll remember and No, DeForest, I'm telling you, it happens to everybody. So a few days later, I'm observing DeForest Kelly come into the studio, as he did every morning, and stop at what we call the craft service table, where there was food. Now, the studio would put out, or the production company put out food, not because they were kindly, but they wanted you filled with energy, and so you better eat lots of sugar and fat, because they wanted you at top performance. So I would watch DeForest come in every morning, go over to the bagels, take a bagel, slice a bagel, put it in the toaster, push down the toaster, and wait, because he was going to get a bagel. I would see this every morning. So one morning, Leonard came in at the same time and said, "Leonard, distract Deke." So Leonard says, "DeForest, come over here, man. I got something in my eye." And when DeForest leaves, I pop the toaster, I grab the bagel, I put the toaster back to him. DeForest comes back, and he's waiting for the bagel, and it pops up.
Depends.
We just lost Coco the Gorilla. I don't know, have you heard? No, really. Coco the Gorilla just died at the age of 46. And this was an amazing animal who could communicate. She knew several hundred words. And you actually had the opportunity. You were invited.
Oh, yeah.
And I was wondering, since...
Great moments of my life.
Yeah, would you please share it with us?
No, seriously, I did. They, an environmental group, asked me to get some publicity for them. And the idea was for me to go visit with Coco, whom I had heard of. She was at Stanford and being taught. At that time, she could sign 600 words. And she communicated. I mean, she was, I love you, this is mine, I want, you know, she was, she talked. If you knew American Sign Language, you would talk to her. I didn't know sign language, but what she would do is say, and there was a great deal of intelligence there. My meeting had a lot of drama to it, in that I was fearful. So, you know, when I came to Stanford, they had her in an enclosure, like a cage with her dress, her living room, really. And so I walked in the door, and there she was seated in a chair, like you are there. And she's a 600-pound gorilla. And I'm looking at her, and oh my God, I'm doing this for publicity, for a cause, but I could feel like I was afraid, like this, you know. This. And I'm an animal person, I'm horses and dogs, that's all I do. And Michelle Nichols, that's it. And so I'm like this, you know, and I think, this is not good nonverbal language, this is not gonna go well. So, but as an actor, I know that you can change the whole thing by speaking. So I said, Coco, I love you. And now I'm like this. This is perfect. She's looking at me the way you're looking at me. Perfect. So I threw caution to the winds, and I advanced. Hey, I love you, Coco. Hi, Coco. Oh, Coco, you're laughing. Hi, Coco. Oh, the Coco baby. It's a little Coco baby. Hello, Coco. And Coco takes her hand and goes back of my neck like this and pulls me down like this. And I go, ha, 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 ha. Hi, Coco, the nice Coco. It's a little Coco girl. And then she reaches with that hand. And she takes me by the balls. Oh, Coco. No, Coco. Don't squeeze, Coco. And then she let go, and we had some more time with her. But she really did all that. It was really
now that is
how do you feel playing Coco? You have a casting call. You want the part of Coco or not?
I'll take it.
You have to do everything the script calls for.
Yeah, what the hell?
You're not Michelle Nichols, but you're a good looking guy.
I want to bounce back a little bit in your career, because another iconic moment from your career that I think everyone in the audience knows is your performance on the television series The Twilight Zone.
I forgot.
That was amazing, because you're a panicky passenger on an airplane, and there's this animal that looks like a hillbilly's rendering of Bigfoot. Dancing around.
That's exactly right. It was a Czechoslovakian acrobat.
Is that true?
Yeah. Dressed in a furry suit. It was like a panda bear. And here's this thing's going 500 miles an hour. They didn't even put wings on it, you know, make it look aerodynamic, give it some reality. It's like, you know, no, it's a Czechoslovakian. But it shows you what must be being tapped in our psyche for people to release that disbelief and go with the Czechoslovakian acrobat in a panda suit as an animal, as a being, as an entity on the wing of a jet. And that was very popular, and I think tapping into our psyche about fear of flight, but it resulted in great fun for my kids, who were, you know, young, below teen, and we'd go fly somewhere, and they'd say, "Daddy, do the look, Daddy." So I turned to the airplane's window, you know, I'd be looking out the window, and one of the girls would say, Miss, come here quickly!" And the stewardess would come running out, the flight attendant would come running out, "What's the matter?" And I'd be looking out, and I'd go. Freaked them out.
That says a lot about your performance. I don't think you could do that now.
That I could do it now?
You couldn't do that now.
No, I couldn't have done that.
Airline regulations.
Yes, no.
How about another question from our audience? This is from Carissa, in Colorado Springs. She traveled all the way up from the Springs to see you tonight.
Colorado Springs, I was there recently making a speech. Were you there? Did you see the speech? I talked about people breeding too much.
Breeding or breathing?
Breeding.
If you could play...
Brought the house down.
How bad?
Yeah. I mean, brought the house down.
If you could play any other Star Trek character, who would you play and why?
That's actually a good one.
George... I play Sulu, so I wouldn't have to deal with George Takei. That's who I play. I don't think he'd mind.
No, that's not... That feud, that's not real.
What's not real?
The George Takei and you, the feud.
He's nuts. He's nuts. There's a silence coming over the audience. They refuse to believe he's nuts. No, he's okay. He's all right. He's not nuts.
Can we talk about something spiritual?
Please. I thought we were talking about George Takei.
By the way, if you don't know, and you should, Bill has a television series on NBC, Better Late Than Never. You see it? It's great! It's wonderful with Henry Winkler. Who else is on?
Henry Winkler, Terry Bradshaw, George Foreman.
George Foreman.
Wonderful. Great guys.
A lot of charisma.
I don't see George, but I see Terry all the time, see Henry all the time. It's great.
I understand that you were genuinely touched, moved by Buddhism when you were shooting.
Well, you know, yes.
So would you talk about that a little bit? Because I think that's the thing people don't talk about that.
You know, every religion talks about reality, our vision of reality, and how what we're seeing and doing and hearing isn't really real, there's other realities. And now we got into quantum physics. Science has proven that we have no idea what reality is. We're talking here, there's an audience there, and it may or may not be happening. But I really discovered this whole dimension. I was shooting a series a long time ago on Gaia, the theory that the Earth is alive. And I was up in the foothills of Everest near a Buddhist temple. And there were several holy mountains that the Nepalese think are places where the gods reside, and or spirits reside. And in this confluence, in this valley, and you can see Everest over there, there was a large Buddhist temple over here. And then our little tiny film group living in a shack over there. But I didn't live in the shack. I took my bedroll every night, ice cold, 14,000 feet, you know, and stayed outside because I was in the holiest of places, one of the holy places where the spirit world lives, apparently. And I wanted to feel it. I wanted to absorb it. And so I spent 7 nights there, nothing. just the whistling of the wind, and there's no sound of animals, no bird calls, it's too high. Everything is dead, or seems to be dead. And nothing was there. And finally, the last night, I despondently packing my bag up, and then it hit me that I didn't need to be there in the place that so many people think of as spiritual. I didn't need to be there to be spiritual. That what I was looking for could be attained anywhere, could be attained here with us having fun tonight, being together tonight. This moment, right now, this moment is a moment that the actor and the audience are together, at one. It's fantastic. Right now, listen to me, we're together. And it's this same moment right now is what we're all looking for. We'll forget it, we'll lose it. But right at this moment, this communion that we all are having is a magical moment. And I didn't need to be in the foothills of Everest to have it. That's what I heard.
That's beautiful. That's so beautiful. We build on each other, but that's really meaningful. Thank you for sharing that with us. I want to talk about a couple of other topics in the time that we have left. I know that you have a deep love for horses, and now you have a place in Kentucky. Do you call them ranches in Kentucky? I really don't know. Like we call them ranches here.
I had years ago one, then years ago another one, and now I have a house there. But I have horses at various stables there, so I'm very active in the horse world. I in California, I'm a reiner. I have quarter horses, and I compete actively. I've gotten quite good at it. I win on occasion when the horse and rider when there's a great deal of luck involved. You have to be absolutely precise as a reiner. You know, you do four turns, and if you don't stop right there, and you stop right there, you're probably out of the running for first place. So it's precarious, and skill, and luck, and the horse, how the horse is feeling, you know, whether the flag waves. So I'm a reiner, and I have horses in Kentucky. I also have won championships with trotting horses, a roadster to bike, we call it. And show horses, American Saddlebred. So I'm really involved with horses. Horse Charity, the Hollywood Charity Horse Show, raises money for veterans and for children. And many of the charities are hippo therapy, horse. So my life is a lot of horses.
What do you get out of your involvement with animals that you don't get out of acting or performing or writing or the other things that you do?
I tell you what I'm discovering. So I also breed Dobermans, and I'm in the midst of the puppy and the thing. And I've got a great girl. She's five now. I wanted to get her pregnant, but she wouldn't catch it. So she is this great Doberman who's the balance between sharpness and love. So she's a great guard dog, but she's also like one of the great lovers. Like Nichelle Nichols. So she'll put her head on my cheek, and there's a picture on my phone with her. The purity of the love of a dog is sometimes, in my life, let me put it that way, the loss of a dog has more pain involved in the loss of a dog than there has been in some human beings that I've known well. The horses are mystical. The horses are a prey animal. And so they're always on the alert that something's going to eat them momentarily. So they can't be thinking of yesterday. They don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. All they know is the sun is there, there's grass there, there's nobody around that's going to eat me. I'll think about it. Okay, I'll do what you say. I'll move over there with your leg. And I'll move over here. Okay, hey, I'm liking this. I'll do this. They live in the now. And if anything that horses can teach us, living in the now is all we do.
You just tied it back into Buddhism.
That's exactly right. Everything leads you back to that kind of philosophy.
Here's a question from Christopher in Denver. Do you feel as though we are closer to Gene's, that would be Gene Roddenberry's utopia, his vision of the future, or further away than when you first came aboard the Enterprise more than 50 years ago?
The question of where the Earth, where the world is evolving. Are we evolving and getting better? Or are we evolving and getting worse? And I don't think there's an answer, because sometimes we're making two steps ahead and then we drop a step behind. But what has changed for me is the internet and the instant communication that one nation has with another, so there are no surprises anymore. And doing that, and let me tell you something I'm doing, which may suggest the answer to that question. Through a series of circumstances on the internet, it is my feeling that those terrible things that people say on the internet, cloaked in anonymity, and they say terrible things, and it's mean, and it's spiteful, and it's ugly. That's the minority. Through a series of experiences, America and the world, but I'll take America, is filled with people like us. We're good people. We want the best. We want to help. We want to do what's right. Things get in the way, but as we try, in the trying, we're better. And having that instant communication with each other and the world, I'm calling it Ubuntu, which is a Swahili word for humanity. Ubuntu discovery is my attempt, and you, if you go to WilliamShatner.com, you'll understand what I'm talking about, of trying to use Twitter and Facebook and the social media for neighborly good. I'm trying to organize the fan club so we're in a variety of neighbors, or you too can get a hold of me through website and say, my neighbor needs some help. Is there anybody out there who can help me get some tires for the truck? Help buy lunches for the kids who can't afford it? And through the power of all of us, $5, nothing that would hurt you. Just if you want to do some good for another human being, Ubuntu discovery should be able to give you the opportunity, just on a whim. It's not going to hurt. It's not going to be, I want thousands of dollars. $5 to a neighbor. Remember the days, and there's somebody backstage who worked on those farms, the ranches here in Colorado, the barn burned down. Neighbors would come the next day, and the neighborhood would put back the barn. And it was a neighborly thing to do, because everybody knew you could depend on your neighbors for help in an emergency. They were your neighbors. The social media that is upon us now is a device for ugliness or for good, for Ubuntu. So try it, see what happens. It's an experiment. Come with me on WilliamShatner.com.
That's WilliamShatner.com. I will tell you, I follow you on Twitter. Do you guys follow this man on Twitter?
Mm-hmm.
You really shut some fools down. You're nice about it usually, but you don't brook any bullshit.
Well, you know why? Why not speak the truth? Why not just, what the hell?
Yeah.
You know, bullshit multiplies, but tell the truth, that's how I feel. I don't understand why we can't say, this is my opinion, and you say, well, I don't agree with that opinion. Why do we have to come to fisticuffs? Why can't we say, oh, well, that's your opinion, that's my opinion. Based on my experience, I got a filter. My life experience tells me this, and your life experience, of course, you're going to have something different to say. This book, Live Long and dot, 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 is I can't tell you what to do. Nobody can tell you. After your age of 10, your parents really can't tell you what to do because you've got your own opinion. You're seeing life through your own filters. So I can say, this is what I did, and maybe it'll work for you, maybe not. Make up your own mind. But the temerity to suggest, oh, you should go to Harvard. What do you mean? I mean, maybe I want to work on a farm. You know what I mean? So that's the Buddhist view.
One of the things that has consistently amazed me about you my entire life since I started paying attention to Star Trek reruns is that you're always so prolific. You never slow down. You write the tech war books, you direct movies, you have these animals you work with, you have a television, and we could go on and on. Miss Congeniality 1 and 2. I mean, what motivates you every day when a lot of your contemporaries would just allow themselves to fade?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I'm just hungry to experience life. And, you know, I live to be here. This is where I am. I am so afraid of dying. Okay? I don't want to die. There's so much in life. God, the sunset in Colorado. I performed at the Red Rock Canyon thing. We were talking about Red Rock Canyon. I performed at Red Rock Canyon. You could feel the spirit of the Indians. You could feel the rocks reverberating. The age. There's so, the world, life is so wonderful. And I keep reading about people dying. You better get my autograph right away because it's going to go up in price and moment I die. I don't want to die. I'm afraid of dying, so I'm trying to do as much as possible, I guess. That's what I'm doing.
Would you autograph my
camera? Yeah, right away.
Oops! We might as well ask!
Here we go. This is very smart of you.
Thank you. Who has been the most impactful person in your whole life? This is asked from Amariah from Boulder. The most impactful person in your entire life, William Shatner.
The most important person. I never had a hero. I don't know what that is. I never looked at, I want to be like him. Yeah, Marlon Brando was a wonderful actor, and he influenced a generation of actors. But Laurence Olivier was a great classical actor. I admired him, so as an actor, I didn't really. So in life, I don't know, people are filled with good and bad, so you see the good and then you see the bad. You know, that goes for your wife. You know. So my father died when he was 68, so he didn't have a chance to disappoint me, I guess. So maybe it was my father who was a good guy. He gave to charity and he worked hard and he supported his family. He came over on the boat in the turn of the 20th century and brought all his siblings over from Europe, and he was 14. He worked hard, he sacrificed for his family. He was an honest man, and you know, maybe that, unbeknownst to me, he was a role model. But I lacked that. And I admire somebody who says, I admire that person, I want to be like that. Wow, I wish I had somebody to do that to, with, or by.
Okay, let's go back to the Wrath of Khan while we're still here. Thank you everybody for being here tonight. I think that we actually touched on some really beautiful subjects. This is really nice. Anything unusual ever happened on or off the set of The Wrath of Khan when it was a production film?
Anything unusual ever happened? Good Lord. It was an unusual movie. Well, I've never told this story. Yeah. Okay. No, I gotta get that. Open them up. So, we shot Star Trek in the studio most of the time. We had movable rocks. So we had a stage filled with movable rocks, and they move a rock there, and move a rock there, and there was a new planet. You hide behind a rock, you come behind a rock. But every so often we'd go out to the earthquake zone, not the Sun Key, the San Andreas, thank you. The San Andreas Fault is within about 50 miles of the Los Angeles, and it's where the uplift, where the tectonic plates, North American plate and the Asian plate, are clicking in themselves. So there's this thing, and it looks like another planet. So we go out there every so often. We cherished going out. But the problem going out on location was that it was an hour to an hour and a half drive, and you had to start at the moment the sun rose. Time was precious. So you had to be on set. The moment the sun gave enough light for the film, we were using film, to be exposed, you had to be ready. So you had to leave in the dark. One day, we were gonna go to San Andreas Fault, and I said to them, I have an idea. I said to the producer, gee, Liz, why don't I get into the costume, the uniform, the captain's uniform, at home? I'll take it home with me tonight, and in the morning, early morning, I'll put it on, I'll bring my clothes, and I'll save a half an hour where I'm already in costume. All I have to do is get into makeup, and I'm ready. I'll save myself a half an hour of sleep. He said, okay, take the wardrobe home. So I took the wardrobe home, and at 4 o'clock in the morning, it's pitch black, I put on the captain's uniform. And I get into my car, and I drive to the San Andreas Fault. Now, I'm a great driver, okay? My family, timid little ladies, grandchildren, daughters, wives, they're timid. They don't like to go 100 miles an hour. But I'm a trained driver. I have done those celebrity races innumerable times. I've gone 125 miles an hour down, make a right-hand turn, do the chicane curve. I'm really good. I was in North Carolina, NASCAR, and you go 190 miles an hour, 200 miles an hour of those. They got regular cars, but it's huge, and then they've got this dam, this air dam on the back of the trunk, which suppresses the rear end. So the faster you go, the more the air is flowing over the dam and compresses the tires. So now in my road lessons and races on it, you come to a curve and you drift pretty slow in, drift around the curve, and then faster. Slow in, faster. And NASCAR, you go fast in and faster out. You don't drift because this thing is suppressed. But I couldn't get it out of my head. And I was in competition, and I had to get above 190 miles an hour to be part of the race. And I kept going 100%. I'd slow down as I came in, I'd speed up. Damn! Now, I've also, over the years, trained in judo, jiu-jitsu, and there's your key. It's just below your belly button. There, my belly button. So just below your belly button is your key, and you release your key. You see these guys break bricks and stuff like that? So you summon your energy. Your whole spirit is in your key. And you break your hand, actually. It's your key, okay? Coming to the curve, and I gotta go 190 miles an hour. And I think, I'm gonna release my key as I come around. I'm going 180, I press that accelerator, and I release the key as I come around the curve. Yeah! And I go around, and I qualify. Now they have cameras in the car. So when the show comes on, I watch myself. My wife, watch me release my key. And you know what comes out? So I know how to drive fast, okay? So now it's 4 o'clock in the morning, and I am driving fast, boy, because I know how to drive fast, and I see in the rearview mirror, I pull over. I mean, I was going, probably going 100 miles an hour. And he comes up. Now, these California troopers, they wear that hat, you know, they're all spick and span, 4 o'clock in the morning. And they wear sunglasses. They're wearing sunglasses, it's pitch black. And it comes up to my window, and his mask behind the sunglasses. Your license, please? I hand him my license. And he says, get out of the car, please. I get out of the car. I turn and face him. And he's looking at me with the sunglasses on, so I can't see his eyes. And he says, where are you going so quickly in the dark? And I think to myself, okay, I gotta do it. I gotta do it. I said, I gotta get to my spaceship, okay? Prosper, it gets in a high quality.